ये तो बात नहीं है, तकरीबन बता कुछ।
बात
गुड मॉर्निंग सर।
आरती मैम पीछे हट जा थोड़ा सा।
Good morning, all of you. Respected Vice Chancellor, Professor Neeraj Gupta, esteemed guest speaker of the day, Professor Mugesh from IIC Bangalore, all deans and HODs of Central University of Rajasthan who have joined us online, all other faculty colleagues, research scholars and students, and all my dear friends. Very good morning to all of you. We have gathered here for the third Dr. Sunil G. Naik Memorial Lecture. Dr. Sunil G. Naik joined this university in 2012 and soon rose through the ranks to went on to become the head of the department and the dean of this school, the School of Chemical Sciences and Pharmacy in the Central University of Rajasthan in 2015. Prior to that, he had completed his PhD from Karnataka University and had a postdoctoral stint at Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore. He also had postdoctoral stints in the Emory University and he then came back to India and took up the position here as associate professor in the School of Chemical Sciences and Pharmacy Department of Chemistry. Dr. Naik, with his vision and his style of work, inspired all of us. In fact, in a very short span of time when he led this department and school, we could see his style of leadership. We could see what kind of true academician he was. And it felt as if he was just born to achieve in this environment. He was just was cut out for this academic environment and the kind of potential.
Survive. This is not enough.
There is some problem. There's nothing visible.
So in 2019, we started with this Dr. Sunil G. Nayak Memorial Lecture, and here we stand today, the third iteration of the lecture. And we are very privileged and honored to have Professor Mugesh from IIC Bangalore as our speaker, as the speaker for the Sunil G. Nayak Memorial Lecture today. Now, before I go on to introduce our speaker to you, we are also very fortunate to have our Vice Chancellor here with us in our midst today. And before we go on to introduce our speaker, I request our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Neeraj Gupta, to share his thoughts on the occasion.
Good morning, everybody. Respected Dr. Mugesh, so kind of you to have joined us for this occasion. All the students, HODs, faculty members, research scholars, and those who have joined us offline and online. It's a privilege for me to be here, and I'm thankful to the department for inviting me for this event, which is a very important scientific event for two reasons. One, we have a very distinguished speaker before us, Dr. G. Mugesh, who is known for the work that he has done for the scientific world, especially when you look at the endocrine systems, the thyroid hormones, and all the things that he is going to talk about. I am not going into the detail. I only know him through a lot of research, and I had an opportunity for a very brief meeting, probably you may not even remember, when he had come here for one day program in our teachers training institute here. So thank you, Dr. Mugesh, for agreeing to be with us. Thank you all for inviting me. I would not take a lot of time because I understand that Dr. Mugesh has to leave at around 10:15. So I would rather invest time in looking at his work, listening to him. And at this point of time, all I can say is that if one thing that we have to learn, I mean, a lot of science that we can talk about, but one thing that we all can learn from Sunil Nayak is his demeanor, his personality, his polite behavior, and his commitment and dedication. And I am saying this not out of a textbook learning. There were many occasions when I worked with him very, very closely. And one of them was a CUSET exam for the day. And I can tell you that very rare to find a person who can keep calm under that stress. So he was one of those persons who will take all the pressure inside and still remain calm. So that is one part of it. In fact, probably one of the occasions I told him very candidly, I said, you should not keep everything inside. You should just bust out your emotions if you're not feeling comfortable with certain things. But he was too decent for that. A very, 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 very polite, very professional, very amiable person. And I'm sure those who have not seen his teaching or not have met him would definitely miss something. But surely a lot of people in this department, I find they carry his demeanor, and that is a tradition I'm sure all of you will carry as you move on to the other things. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, sir, for the words and for also, you know, your thoughts on Dr. Sunil G. Nayak and some of the we are definitely able to relate with all the characteristics that you had just mentioned on Dr. Nayak, and we'll certainly try to imbibe some of those in the way we conduct ourselves in this department going forward. Now it's time to introduce our speaker of the day for the Dr. Sunil G. Nayak Memorial Lecture, Professor Mugesh. Professor Mugesh, amidst all his commitments, has graciously consented to deliver this memorial lecture. We are so happy and privileged and honored by his consent. Professor Mugesh certainly doesn't need any introduction. His academic achievements speak volumes for themselves. However, I would take this opportunity to just shed some light on some of the illustrious achievements that he has had in his career. Professor Mugesh completed his PhD from IIT Bombay, and he got the prestigious Alexander von Humboldt Fellowship which was followed by another postdoctoral stint with none other than Professor Casey Nicolau in Scripps in the USA. And upon his return, he took up this position in the Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore, in 2002. And he has been a trailblazer as far as his research career is concerned. Some of the research that he has carried out, in fact, as also pointed out rightly by our Vice Chancellor, in the area of bioinorganic materials and also core inorganic chemistry, have inspired thousands and thousands of people in our country, and has really been path-breaking science that he has carried out. The list of awards is very lengthy to be actually spelled out over here in this short time span, but I would still just mention a few of his illustrious awards that he has got. In 2005, right after in a very short span of time after he joined the Ministry of Science, he got the IUPAC Young Scientist, Young Chemist Award, and which was followed by Swarna Jayanti Fellowship in 2008. And quickly he rose in his research career. In 2012, he was conferred with the Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Prize, which is one of the highest prizes that we have in research in our country. In 2003, he got the Fellow of the Royal Society of Chemistry Fellowship. And he also has, of course, achieved the CRSI medals. And in 2015, he got the prestigious J.C. Bose Fellowship. And then later on, he got it twice. And similarly, he has also been the Vice President of the Chemical Research Society of India, the highest society for research in chemistry in the country, and he has again been the vice president of it twice. He has also got the prestigious JSPS invitation fellowship from Japan in the year 2016, and like I just mentioned, he has been a trailblazer in research activities. So he has been the president of the Asian Chemical Editorial Society. He's also, of course, a member of the science academies in the country, FNA and FNAC, that's the International Science Academy, and the National Science Academy of India. He's the editorial board member of several leading journals such as Chemistry European Journal, Organic and Biomolecular Chemistry, ACS Omega, etc. In fact, he has even been the guest editor of a special edition of ChemCom, Chemical Communications, a special edition on Indian chemists. And he is also a chairperson of several leading scientific activities and committees in the country, such as the Program Advisory Committee of CERB, which is instrumental in all research funding that is being actually distributed in the country. So I'm sure that research excellence is in great hands of Professor Mugesh in our country. And he's also, of course, a member of all leading scientific societies, such as the American Chemical Society, the Royal Society of Chemistry, the AVH Association, etc. And having said all this, his research, when you come to his research, of course, what we are really happy and proud is that whatever research he has carried out is very closely associated with the research that was the research domain of Dr. Sunilji Nayak also. And in fact, Dr. Sunilji Nayak had a close association and bond, shared a bond with Professor Mugesh. And as I had mentioned, the Science Academy's refresher course and the lecture workshop, which had been organized, was organized under the leadership of Dr. Sunil Nayak and the guidance of Professor Mugesh. So they had a real nice interaction going there. And in fact, we are so happy that we have Professor Mugesh delivering this lecture today, as his research on chemical biology, bioinorganic, and medicinal chemistry is very much closely associated with the kind of research that was carried out by Dr. Sunilji Nayak. So with these words, as already been mentioned, Professor Mugesh is, in fact, he has another meeting to attend to at 10:30 with the DST FIST. And so really, we are very thankful to him for consenting to this lecture. So without taking much more time, I would now request Professor Mugesh to deliver the third Dr. Sunilji Nayak memorial lecture. Professor Mugesh, please.
Yeah, good morning. Thank you, Dr. Ishwar, for the kind introduction, and Professor Gupta for making it to this meeting. I'm happy to deliver this talk, and I had interactions with Dr. Sunil Naik when he was here as a postdoc, and I knew that. But he contacted me sometime in 2014 to organize a refresher course at the Department of Chemistry, University of Rajasthan. And I agreed to that because the discussion that he had a very clear plan how he wanted to conduct the refresher course. And the refresher course was held during January 12 to 25, 2015. And I visited the university and stayed there for a few days. And he had excellent organization skills. And many people benefited by this course at that time. I think the head of the department was Professor Pardasani, and we had a lot of interactions that time. And after that, I became busy, and one day I called his on his mobile much later, and someone picked up the phone and said, he is no more. Okay, and it was a shock for me because, you know, the type of, you know, very good human being, you know, interactions. And however, I'm happy to deliver this talk, which is established in memory of Dr. Naik. And today, I thank all the organizers for doing this. And when I was contacted by Dr. Iswar, I had no hesitation to accept. It's only that, you know, the time constraint was a problem, but we are able to, you know, finally make it. So in today's talk, I will talk to you on one of our recent activities. I will share you the slide. So are you able to see the slide?
Yes, sir. Yes, yeah. I can see. Yes.
Okay. Yeah. So I'm going to talk to you on a single atom change on biological activity, thyroid hormones and membrane transport. So I will start with very fundamental aspects of thyroid hormones. As the vice chancellor mentioned, you know, thyroid hormone is one of my favorite topics, and because that is a very, very interesting research field which is emerging at the interface of chemistry and biology. So we all know about, you know, the elements which are important for biological functions. We can call them as the chemistry, the elements of life, right? We can list approximately 28 elements, which are the elements of life. So they support life. And I highlighted two groups in the periodic table. One is group 16 elements and group 17 elements. So group 16, if you consider oxygen, sulfur, selenium, and tellurium, and group 17, fluorine, chlorine, bromine, iodine. Okay. So how nature selected these atoms for various biological functions, right? And of course, we know oxygen and sulfur are present in many biomolecules, but selenium is rare, but it is essential, right? Without selenium, we cannot survive. But what is interesting is that group 17 elements, if you consider fluorine, chlorine, bromine, and iodine, fluorine, chlorine, bromine are not present in human body, but iodine is present as a thyroid hormone. So it is intriguing how nature connected the selenium and iodine, you know, in biological system. So my entire talk is going to be on selenium and iodine today. Okay. And tellurium is not essential element. Tellurium is toxic to the human. So there is no biomolecule that contains tellurium, but selenium is certainly important. So what about, thyroid hormone? So I have given this, which you are very familiar with it. I think the student starts studying about metamorphosis or the frog cycle from maybe fifth or sixth grade onwards. Okay. And but still a lot of interesting aspects about how this change happens, right? In the frog cycle, the tadpole turns into frog by a process called metamorphosis, right? And this is an important process. Many changes happens in the body, right? And they live primarily in water, but then they start living in water and land. lungs become important and they start breathing through the lungs. So this transformation happens by one molecule, which is called the thyroxine. So thyroxine has a 4 iodine atoms. You can see this all given here. The structure is given here. So the metamorphosis happens because of the presence of thyroxine. Okay, if there is no thyroxine, metamorphosis does not happen. So that means if you grow the tadpole in a water which does not have iodide, then there is no thyroxine synthesis and the metamorphosis doesn't happen. So the tadpole remains tadpole, never turns into frog without this hormone, without this thyroxine. Okay, so that is the beauty of this single molecule, which have 4 iodine atoms. So the Nobel Prize in Physiology and Medicine in 1950 was awarded to Edward Kendall. He worked on thyroxine for many years. So in 1914, he succeeded in isolating 7 grams of thyroxine from 3,000 kilograms of pig thyroid gland. So very small amount which is present the thyroxine present in the thyroid gland. So how thyroxine is synthesized, I will briefly go through this slide. And this all you can link to your daily life, right? Because we take iodized salt and the doctor says it's good for thyroid, right? But where the iodide is used? So it is used to make thyroxine because thyroxine is an iodine containing compound and the iodide is introduced to thyroxine by a series of enzymatic reactions. You can see that iodide is transported inside the thyroid follicular cells by a sodium iodide importer, NIS. So this transport also sodium into the cells. Once the iodide is transported, it is incorporated into a protein called thyroid peroxidase, which is a heme peroxidase, which use hydrogen peroxide and iodide to iodinate thyrosyl residues. Okay, and how the protein thyroglobulin is synthesized from the cells, through the normal protein synthesis pathway on ribosomes. Once the thyroglobulin is synthesized, it has multiple thyrosyl residues, and those residues get iodinated by thyroid peroxidase using the iodide and hydrogen peroxide as the substrate. Okay, this is where the iodide is required. So once the thyrosyl residues are iodinated, then the same enzyme mediates another important chemical reaction, which is a phenolic coupling reaction. So 2 iodinated thyrosyl residues are coupled together to form a thyroxine, which has an ether linkage. And then endocytosis and proteolysis cleave the T4 as a free amino acid. So T4 is the only biomolecule in human body that has 2 phenyl ring linked by an ether linkage and the only biomolecule in human body that contains iodine. So very unique features of thyroid hormones. And this reaction happens only in the thyroid gland. So that's the reason when somebody undergoes surgery for thyroid cancer or other thyroid related problems, the person should take synthetic thyroxine throughout the life because once the thyroid gland is removed, the person cannot produce thyroxine. So because no other parts of the body can produce thyroxine. And for many years, people thought that the T4 is the hormone, but later on, sometime in 1990s, people found that there are enzymes which selectively remove iodine from thyroxine to make it biologically active or biologically inactive. So that means T4 is a prohormone which requires a mono deiodination reaction. So that is a removal of 1 iodine from T4 makes this hormone biologically active. So this removal of iodine from the inner ring of thyroxine can produce a reverse T3, which is biologically inactive. Both are equally important because if only the activation pathway is operative, it leads to hyperthyroidism. If only the inactivation pathway is operative, it leads to hypothyroidism. So therefore, a perfect balance of T3 and reverse T3 is important for the body to maintain the physiological functions. And these enzymes which mediate such transformations are selenoenzymes. They contain selenocysteine in the active site. It's a very, very unique enzyme. And selenocysteine, why nature chose selenocysteine? Because the pK of the selenol group in this protein is 5.2 as compared to the cysteine, which has a pK of 8.3, or the serine, which has a pK of 13. So therefore, The selenocysteine is considered as a highly powerful nucleophile in the in biological system, and that's the reason nature selected selenocysteine, which is considered as the 21st amino acid, and incorporated into the protein. And the, these enzymes are called iodothyronine deiodinases, IDs. So they selectively remove iodine from T4, either from the inner, from the outer ring or from the inner ring, to make it biologically active or inactive. So for we were intrigued by the mechanism, and we wanted to functionally mimic these enzymes by small molecules, because you know, we can understand the mechanism, you know, how these remove iodine and so on, but it is not easy. Although people say, you know, carbon iodine bond can be more polarized than carbon bromine or carbon chlorine, but thyroxine, the carbon iodine bond is very, very stable. So it cannot use any nucleophile to remove the iodine. So it we started this work sometime in 2002 after I joined IISc, but we did not get any success for many years. And the students who made the selenium compounds in the laboratory tested them for deiodination reactions, and we could not succeed with any of those compounds. We tested hundreds of selenium compounds, and none of them were able to remove iodine from thyroxine. And then we looked at the active site of the enzymes, and we found that, you know, this is the selenocysteine, U is selenocysteine, and then threonine, after that there is a cysteine. So we thought there may be some role for the cysteine residues in addition to the selenocysteine. And we thought if you have a selenol and thiol like this, we can make a selenosulfide, intramolecular selenosulfide, and that can be reduced to the selenol and thiol by using DTT or any other reducing agent. So with that in mind, we prepared this particular compound with the thiol containing naphthalene, and we introduced the selenium at the periposition. So the 1,8 positions in naphthalene are called the peripositions, right? And so we introduced the selenium here, and we made a selenosulfide. So this was the beginning of our successful story about thyroid hormone, you know, activation using synthetic compounds. But this happened in 2010. So it took nearly 8 years to find out a compound that can remove, you know, remove iodine from thyroxine. So this was the first paper that appeared on this topic. What we did, we took T4 and this compound, and we treated these two in phosphate buffer at pH 7.5, 37 degree, the body temperature. And we found that one iodine is removed from T4. The HPLC clearly indicated that there is a new peak in the HPLC, right? And when we isolated and characterized, we were a bit surprised to know that it is not the T3 removal of iodine from the outer ring, but it's a reverse T3 where the iodine from the inner ring has undergone deiodination reactions. And when you take T3 again, the inner ring deiodination takes place under similar conditions, and it produces T2. And it was a bit surprise for us because it's highly specific to inner ring deiodinations. If you look at the crystal structure of T4, all 4 iodine atoms are exposed. You can see the outer ring is perpendicular to the inner ring, right? So all 4 iodines are exposed. So if the compound wants to remove iodine, they can actually, it can remove all 4 iodine. But what happens after removal of one iodine? So it stops. So the quantitative conversion of T4 to reverse T take place. No change in the selectivity and no change, no further deiodination. So this was the first report on this. And after that, we were able to compare many compounds. So what we did, we substituted, you know, one thiol, one selenol here. We substituted the selenol with another thiol. So we have a 2 thiol, one selenol, and 2 selenols, and compared the activity. And again, we found something interesting, right? You can see this is very less active, the 2 thiol group. One thiol and one selenol is 12 times more active, but if you substitute the second thiol with the selenol, it increases the activity. So 91-fold increase in the activity, and further increase was observed when you put an amino group here, which can deprotonate this thiol or selenol. But when we block the second selenium atom by substituting that with the phenyl group, and we see that the activity is almost lost. So this gives some clue that it's not just the selenium here, but the selenium at the 8th position is also important for the biological activities. So what we've shown is that increase in the reactivity does not change the selectivity, because by substituting that with the 2-selenol or introducing an amino group to activate the selenol, we were able to get only one compound, that is a reverse T3. So the selectivity is maintained, and we showed that increase in the reactivity does not change the selectivity. And that's the time we started looking at the chemical mechanism, you know, how these compounds are selective to only one iodine and why it's inner ring iodine. So we know in organic halides, these are textbooks examples. In organic halides, the electron density is anisotropically distributed around the halogen atom, right? And this anisotropic distribution become more prominent when you have iodine as a halide, right? And if you look at this is the red color one shown here. This is the sigma bond, okay, the carbon halogen sigma bond. And if you look at this halogen around this belt, which is called the negative belt, and at the tip of the halogen atom, there is a positive potential, which is known as the sigma hole. And the sigma hole increases when you go from fluorine to iodine. You can see this is a fluorine, chlorine, bromine, iodine. The blue color indicates the sigma hole. That is the positive potential. So this sigma hole can interact with the electron-rich atoms, and the positive potential along the CX-axis increases from fluorine to iodine. So the iodine can form much stronger halogen bond as compared to bromine, chlorine, or fluorine. So this may be the reason why nature selected iodine as part of the thyroid hormone, if we think that halogen bonding is playing an important role. So we have done a lot of DFT calculations to understand the sigma hole in thyroid hormones, and found that the electrostatic potential map indicates that all four iodine atoms have sigma hole. So that sigma hole is the location of the positive potential. Okay, you can see that. And we did further calculations to identify, to determine the strength of halogen bonding. You can see here, the selenium iodine interactions is 23.43 kilocalorie per mole when you do not have any atoms here. But this becomes much stronger. You can see this, it becomes 68, almost three times more when you put an additional group here. So initially we were confused, what is the role of this additional group here? It's not the through bond because it's quite far away. But then we found that there is a through space interaction between the two chalcogen atoms. Okay, when this selenium lone pair interact with the sigma hole, a halogen bond is formed, and that lead to elongation of the carbon iodine bond. When this becomes electron deficient because of the halogen bond, the second atom starts interacting with this. Okay, then that leads to the cleavage of the carbon iodine bond. Okay, and this was the first time we showed that if you put two chalcogen atoms, sulfur selenium, the halogen bond strength can be increased because of the peri interactions between these selenium atoms. And this is called chalcogen bond. So a cooperative chalcogen and a halogen bond was responsible for the deiodination reaction. So finally, we showed a mechanism, a cooperative halogen and halogen and chalcogen bonding. So initially, the lone pair interact with the sigma star antibonding orbital of a carbon iodine bond, leading to the elongation of the carbon iodine bond. And then you can see that it leads to the strengthening of the halogen bond. And then when the second selenium starts interacting, leads to the cleavage of carbon iodine bond. This is the unique mechanism that we showed for the deiodination of thyroid hormones. And this was highlighted by other people, this is important, right? So then obviously what we think, sulfur is inactive, but when we go to selenium, it become active, but the selectivity is maintained. So we think as a chemist, we think what will happen if you go down the periodic table. So let us use a tellurium compound. Okay, why nature avoided the tellurium? So can we give some reason based on our studies? Okay, and we prepared this tellurium-based compound, sulfur tellurium and sulfur tellurium here. And this is the HPLC, which is not as clean as as the, you know, the previous case, and we calculated the rate of the reactions and so on. But what we found was interesting. So when we have the tellurium compounds, the T4 undergo innering deiodination to produce reverse T3 and outering deiodination to T3 and then further deiodination to 3'T2, then 3'T1, 3T1, finally it goes to T0 where no iodine atom is present. So we are not able to control the reactivity, right? So when we move from selenium to tellurium, the reactivity completely changes. The tellurium is too reactive to control the selectivity. So it removes all four iodine atoms and it gives a T0, right? And that's the reason probably, you know, nature stopped at selenium, did not go to tellurium. It's too reactive to control the selectivity. So what we found was, you know, that relative conformation between the outer phenyl ring and the inner phenyl ring is important to maintain the selectivity. And we have got X-ray structures of thyroxine at different polymorphs, and we compared the dihedral angles. And finally, what we have shown is that you can have a dihedral angle where both outer ring and inner ring iodine can form equally strong halogen bond with the electron donors. And you can also have conformations where outer ring becomes more favored than the inner ring. So we provided an explanation for this process. You know, this is one of the highlights of our work. A well-known group in this area from Germany wrote about this work. They said almost in passing, they solved the apparent mystery of non-equivalence of thyroxine from different brands. And they provide an attractive explanation for how deiodinases might control regioselectivity through altering the substrate conformation at a distance from the reactive bond. Okay, and you can change the conformation between the two phenyl ring, you know, the dihedral angle, and you can make, you know, either you can remove outer ring iodine or inner ring iodine. Possibly the enzymes fix the conformation such that, you know, which iodine to be removed. So this can be extended to halogenated nucleosides. You can also remove the iodine atoms under mild condition from halogenated nucleosides. So these are involved in DNA damage and so on. So removal of iodine is very easy using these reagents. So halogen bonded mediated. So again, if you substitute the bromine with iodine, you can see halogen bond mediated reactions. But if you have a bromine, it is a Michaelis addition and elimination. So the mechanism also changes by just changing one atom, because whatever we talked about so far, how this one atom change affected the reaction mechanism and the biological activities, right? And this is the X-ray which showed that in fact there are halogen bond formations. So the next few minutes, I'm going to tell you where this halogen bonding can be applied other than, you know, thyroid hormone metabolisms. And we were looking at membrane transport of fluorescent molecules, because T3 is important hormone for brain function. And the T3 enters into the brain using a transporter called MCT8 transporter, which is monocarboxylate 8 transporter. And this is the euthyroid brain, which is a normal brain. But in the hypothyroid brain, there is a mutation that takes place in MCT8, which does not allow the T3 to get into the brain. Okay. And this leads to a genetic defect that is known as Allan-Herndon-Dudley syndrome. This is known since 1944 without knowing its actual cause. Some of the symptoms for this disorder, normal to slightly elevated thyroid stimulating hormone, elevated T3 and reduced T4. Okay, and normal looking at birth and for the first few years, but cannot walk independently and become wheelchair bound by adulthood. So we wanted to develop fluorescent probes for MCT8, and we looked at different type of fluorophores. We chose the naphthalamide based fluorophore. Can we use the halogen bonding as the source, as a strategy to put this compound inside the cells? Otherwise, these compounds do not enter into the cells. And what we synthesized compounds with hydrogen, chlorine, bromine, iodine, two iodines, and so on. And what you see, we studied the fluorescent behavior, you know, and the log P values, how lipophilic they are. Okay. And then what we found is that when we treat the cells with these compounds, you can see the compound 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, they are not taken up by the cells. So we used HepG2 cells, and these are confocal microscopy images. And what we find is the compound 15, for example, that is the one which has two iodine atoms. and a lot of compounds enter into the cells. You can see the fluorescence. And we quantified it and we found that when we have a two iodine atoms here, you can see this two iodine atom here, almost 98% uptake was obtained. So that's amazing because, you know, these compounds do not enter the cells. By introducing just one atom, substituting the hydrogen with the iodine, we are able to increase the cellular uptake up to 98%. And that is due to the halogen bond formation, you know, sigma hole, you can see here, which can interact with the receptor forming a halogen bond. And that allows the compound to enter into the cells. We have also checked in primary cells like human umbilical vein endothelial cells and so on. But all the cases, we found that a significant increase in the uptake. And when we do a competitive inhibition with the thyroid hormones itself, we see that when you use a compound which does not have iodine, there is no inhibition. But when you use a compound which have iodine, you see a lot of inhibition. So that means these compounds are entering through the same transporter. And in this case, it is MCT8. And we used MCT8 specific inhibitor to prove that these compounds are entering into the cells using MCT8 inhibitors. So we prepared many other fluorofluorophores, but attaching iodine, bromine, and so on. And we found that the compounds which have iodine atoms, they enter the cells in very large amount. Almost a quantitative uptake was observed just putting one atom, you know, extra, right? Changing the hydrogen. And this is this type of, you know, compounds. We checked all of them, you know, many, many fluorophores. So simple strategy, just changing one atom, improve the cellular uptake. So we believe that such, you know, compounds will have great applications in biological studies because cellular uptake is a major problem, right? Even drug development, we can develop a drug, you know, agent for various diseases, but if they do not enter the cells, we cannot use them as a drug, right? Cellular uptake is important. And we showed a simple strategy, just one atom change, you can improve the cellular uptake. And we found that, you know, the iodinated compound get into the cells up to 98%, brominated 38%, chlorinated 15%. If you don't have any halogen atoms, almost no cellular uptake was observed. So then what we thought, can we put a protein inside the cells by using this strategy? So far, what we have done was, you know, using a small molecules and we improved the cellular uptake up to 98%. Can we use a protein? And that was initially we thought it is little over ambitious, but you know, later on we were happy that you know, we were able to make green fluorescent proteins introducing chlorine, bromine, iodine, and these are unnatural amino acids. So the natural translational machinery does not accept unnatural amino acids. So we have to expand the genetic code of the organisms to accept the unnatural amino acid. And in this case, we substituted the tyrosine residues at the 39 position on the surface of the protein with the unnatural amino acids. So what we did, we mutated the tRNA synthetase, tyrosine tRNA synthetase, and incorporated the unnatural amino acid using this particular modified strain in bacteria, and we could get the modified protein. And what we did, these are the expression of the protein in bacterial cells. You can see the fluorescent. And we purified that, and this gel electrophoresis tells that the proteins are very clean proteins. And we also got mass, which confirms that all four enzymes are, all four proteins are pure, right? Wild type, chloro substituted, bromo substituted, and iodo substituted. And what we found was that again, one atom in the entire protein, right? This is the 28 chlorodalton protein. So 28,000 is the molecular weight, but only one atom we changed, hydrogen to iodine. And we see that the cells take up this protein and they enter the cells. You can see the one TAG, three iodothyrosine. So one atom, you can see that there is an enhancement, and that gives an idea that by introducing an iodine atom in protein, we will be able to improve the cellular uptake. And we can also cleave that using an endosomal lytic peptide. And because these proteins get trapped in the endosomes because they enter through the caveolin mediated pathways, but we can use peptides like PPTG21, which are endosomal lytic peptides, to cleave the endosomes and release these protein into cytosols. So this again increases the applicability of protein in drugs as a drugs, because we can introduce halogen atoms to these proteins to improve the cellular uptake, and release them into cytosols to perform any reaction. So we are now working on multiple enzyme systems to improve their activity, improve their cellular uptake so that these can be used for biological functions. So with that, I would like to thank the funding agency, Science and Engineering Research Board, my former students, Dr. Debasis Manna, who is now in ICER Bhopal as a faculty, K. Raja, Santanu Mandal. So these three carried out the initial work on the thyroid hormone metabolism using enzyme mimetics, and the RA postdocs who helped in understanding this cellular uptake studies. And I also thank the other students who are working on various aspects of chemical biology. I take students from both chemistry and biology, and we set up a multidisciplinary lab where the work at the interface of chemistry and biology can take place. So I thank you all for your attention. And if you have any questions, I would be happy to answer.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Thank you for the wonderful lecture, Professor Mukesh. Professor Mukesh himself said, he has some time for some discussion. So if there are any questions from the audience, Professor Mukesh would be happy to answer them.
Hello, good morning, sir. It was a very, very nice lecture. It was so good to listen to this lecture as usual. I have heard your previous lectures too, sir. Just a quick query that I had. In the first part, when you put that amino group next to that selenium, so yeah. What was the inspiration behind that, putting a amino group there?
Yeah, in the iodothyronine deiodinases, there is a histidine residue, and people did mutations of those histidine residues, and in fact saw that one of the histidines, in fact, is playing a key role in the catalysis. So the histidine acts as a general base, abstracting the proton and then donating it when the T3 or reverse T3 goes away. So the H plus that protonates the carbon ion is actually coming from the histidine. So that was the reason for introducing a basic amino group near the selenium.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir. One more quick question, sir, that similar to, although I know that this research is inspired from the thyroid hormone, similar results are observed sometimes with the fluorine chemistry also, the bioavailability. Sir, any comments on that?
Fluorine, not in mammalian systems, but there are many bacterial enzymes which use a fluorine. Okay, the lower halogens are used by bacterial enzymes. And the marine organisms, many of the natural products which contain halogen atoms, fluorine, chlorine, bromine, these are introduced by peroxidases, into those organic molecules. So, but in human, fluorine doesn't play much role.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir. It is wonderful to listen to you this morning.
Thank you so much, sir. Very nice lecture. I just have, sir, one query. Is it like the activity arise? Is it because of the chalcogen interaction only, or chalcogen is playing like some other roles also?
Yeah, it is, two chalcogen atoms. One of them, the first one, interact with the iodine is a selenium, right? That is in the protein also, enzyme also, it is a selenium. But the second atom can be anything, right? Any electron donor, even nitrogen, sulfur, selenium, or possibly even phosphorus, right? So we want to make the chalcogen bond stronger to make the halogen bond stronger to break the carbon iodine bond. So that should be, in a way, it should be aligned in a way to interact with the selenium atom. And one question people ask, then why not just sulfur? Why do we need selenium? Because sulfur can form as good, halogen bond as selenium. But the next interaction, that is a chalcogen-chalcogen interaction, selenium is a good electron acceptor than sulfur atom because of, the d orbital participation. That's why selenium is much more preferred. But the one that interacts with the selenium can be anything, nitrogen or oxygen, you know, sulfur. In this case, we have shown sulfur, selenium, but it can be anything else.
Okay, thank you, sir. Just one more laboratory-related query. Once Professor Roisky told me that if you work on chalcogen chemistry, you will not have very good friends in the lab because of the poor smell it has.
Yeah,
so,
yeah.
Is there any way like we can suppress that thing like in working in the lab?
Yeah, that is a very general statement, I would say. And we are working on this, you know, in IASC for 20 years and no smell at all out of our lab because aliphatic selenium compounds are highly smelly, like H2SE, right? Or CH3SEH, methyl selenol or ethyl selenol. Terrible smell. And if you touch that, you cannot eat for 2-3 days. Okay, but the compounds, aromatic selenium compounds are not smelly at all. And the compounds that we make, you can just take it to your nose and smell it. Nothing, you know, no smell at all. Okay. So it depends on the stability of the carbon selenium bond, right? There is a selenium compound which is in phase 3 clinical trial, which is known as epsilon. And you don't, you know, just looking at our, it's a colorless, it's white color. Selenium compounds are generally, you know, yellow or orange. But epsilon is a colorless white color solid. And, you know, even in closed AC room, you don't smell anything at all, right? And so it depends on what type of selenium compounds we are working on. Certainly, we don't want to work with aliphatic selenium compounds, which are less stable. And the carbon selenium bond is cleaved easily. And that is, you know, smells bad.
Thank you so much, sir.
Hello. Thanks.
Yeah.
Thanks for a nice lecture, sir. I have one query. You have shown the importance of selenium-selenium bond for the cleavage of CA bond. I would like to know about what about simple diphenyl diselenide?
No. Because diphenyl diselenide, if you use a reducing agent, it cleaves to give the phenyl selenol, right? And one selenol is not enough to cleave the carbon-iodine bond. We need two selenol interacting with, that's why we used the rigid naphthalene backbone, right? I think we were lucky to choose that in the beginning because that gives the optimum interactions between the selenium and selenium. Diphenyl diselenide we checked and no deiodination at all.
Okay, thank you very much, sir.
So if there are no more questions, we thank Professor Mugesh and I now request one of our faculty colleagues, Dr. Bhanachandra, to propose a formally vote of thanks for the occasion.
So good morning, one and all who gathered here on this wonderful, pleasant morning here on this wonderful occasion. So it's my honor and pleasure to present vote of thanks, okay, so on this loving event. I take this opportunity, golden opportunity to thank the respected speaker, Professor G. Mugesh, who delivered a talk on a very interesting and exciting topic, that is, we have seen that how a single atom can change the biological activity. So I am sure and hope that our MSc students sir might have got inspired by your talk. So thank you, sir, for that. And I extend my gratitude to the respected Vice Chancellor, sir, Professor Neeraj Gupta, sir, and Dean of the school, Amit, sir, for coming here, physical presence, and glorifying this event. So once again, I thank one and all. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Bhanachandra. So with that, we come to the end of this Dr. Sunilji Naik III, Dr. Sunilji Naik Memorial Lecture. We thank Professor Mugesh. Thank you, sir, for taking this time out amidst your busy schedule. And we hope for many such more occasions. And maybe the next time we can have a physical interaction with your presence here amidst us. And we can have more such interactions in the future. So thank you. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, sir.